You're probably having some serious withdrawal symptoms after binging through all of the Queen's Gambit, but don't worry, we have some to tide you over. Despite being a miniseries about chess, The Queen's Gambit has been a fast-paced, exciting, and glossy success on Netflix. Sorry for all the major shade that just threw at chess fans there. But unfortunately for fans of the show, it is just a limited series, meaning that's the lot. Thankfully, though, we've been doing some digging, and like a chess master, we have noticed some hidden details, moves, facts, and general pieces of information you might have missed. In this video, we will take a look at 25 or so, we're kind of loose with the numbers, things you might have missed in The Queen's Gambit. Spoiler warning, we will be discussing the full season of Queen's Gambit, so unless you don't want us to checkmate your spoiler-free life, we suggest you come back to this video another time.
I may have just played the best chess player of my life.
Let's start with the end, shall we? The series had a ton of draining and emotionally taxing moments, but Beth finally gets her chance to travel to the USSR to compete and take on the Grandmasters that once eluded her. But the show ends somewhat openly, in a way which leaves the audience slightly puzzled. As Beth heads to the airport, she asks the driver to stop so she can wander the streets of Moscow, finding herself in a square occupied by older men playing games of chess. As she approaches them, they embrace her as a hero, and she sits down to play with them one-on-one, and that's it. That's the ending. Like The Sopranos, it ends rather abruptly, but also like The Sopranos, it leaves us wondering what it all means. Did Beth defect to the USSR? Does she return to the US? Have the last few moments all been an illusion, and it's all been a concoction of Beth's mind and her substance addictions? Well, if you were fearing a negative ending, Anya Taylor-Joy may have just stopped you worrying, with her stating that it was just a nice moment for the character, where she can just relax and let her hair down and take in her moment of victory. Say it was actually a happy ending. In fact, Taylor-Joy found it so emotional that every time the camera cut, she would begin crying as she becomes so attached to the character. Gosh darn it, now I'm gonna cry! One of the best things about the show is the sensational performance provided by Anya Taylor-Joy, who really took the character into her stride, unafraid to embrace both the highs and the lows of the character. Taylor-Joy is so believable as the character that we have no issue in accepting her as the genius chess player who can quickly strategize off the cuff. But what is surprising that Taylor-Joy didn't know the moves she would have to make until just before shooting. In fact, she only found out what moves she would have to make minutes before shooting, so it would stay fresh in her mind. Which, I mean, I guess you would also have to remember your lines, which is pretty important. But what also makes Taylor-Joy's performance impressive is her physicality and the way she moved, which is very nifty and well choreographed. This is actually a very deliberate move made by Taylor-Joy, who actually used her skills as a former ballet dancer to know how to move her hands in a way which are nifty and cool. Because it probably wouldn't have had the same effect if she had awful depth perception like me and knocked all the pieces over. Speaking of body language and physical movements, the way the actors move are specifically designed for their characters. For instance, Taylor-Joy wanted to make sure that Beth's body language was far different from her male counterparts to make her stand out and show the disparity between the genders. Taylor-Joy said that she made her moves in a quick and ruthless way, but still undeniably feminine, which again, requires not knocking all the pieces over. I'm still banned from all chess tournaments, it happened one time! But Taylor-Joy isn't the only one with easily definable mannerisms, with Thomas Brody Sangster adding the nervous habit his character Benny has, where he is constantly playing with his ring. As we said before, what makes the show so special is that we have no problem finding the characters believable. But it turns out that Taylor-Joy knew almost nothing about chess before the show and had to learn as production went on. But she believes it worked in her favor, as it allowed her to be invited into a secret world, and that it was exciting having to learn all these moves so quickly, and that she was proud about how her brain picked up the moves, or at least tricked her into knowing all the moves. She may have been an amateur at the start, but I don't think I would take her on in a game anytime soon. She wasn't alone in having a limited chess knowledge though, with Brody Sangster and Harry Melling both having very little knowledge of the game. Luckily for the actors, they had some very highly trained and skilled coaches to teach them the ways of the game. And when I say highly trained and skilled, I mean highly trained and skilled, with their teachers being Russian chess master Garry Kasparov and notorious American chess teacher Bruce Pandolfini. In fact, they didn't just teach the actors, but choreographed every move we see in the show. But while the coaches may have choreographed every move, the actors not only had to learn to play the game and every move, but also had to physically play the game, meaning that no extras or doubles came in to play the game for them. I know that playing chess isn't exactly a Tom Cruise-worthy stunt, but still. But it isn't just the actors who had to learn and understand the game, but the VFX team who had to learn so they could bring to life the hypothetical moves Beth plays out in her own mind. So basically, everyone who worked on the show are basically chess masters now. As we said, the actors played every game of chess that occurs in the show, even the ones we don't see. A number of the games are played through close-ups of the actors' faces, a reference to the pawn's sacrifice. But instead of just having the actors pretending to be playing chess, they actually played out the game as if we could see it, meaning that there is an actual game going on out of sight. Talk about method acting! As you probably guessed, with both Kasparov and Pandolfini being involved with the show, the games we see are hyper-realistic. But not only are the games themselves and the strategy behind them realistic, but the setup itself. A number of shows and movies play fast and loose with the setup of the game, a criticism that chess masters usually find. But the masters behind the camera setup and positions are often extremely realistic. If you're thinking, though, that the locations of chess tournaments can't really be that dingy and depressing, you would be wrong. Chess expert Dylan Loeb McLean wrote in the New York Times that he can attest to the fact that tournaments in the era were often played in dingy and odd locations, and despite the grandeur of the tournament, the equipment was often cheap and second-rate along with the furniture, with McLean saying that the atmosphere and setting in the show is painfully accurate. Which is yay, production team, and sorry all chess fans out there. He also went further to commend the show on the way they captured the high tension and drama of real-life chess tournaments, as well as the obsessive qualities some of the competitors have. But also, the games we see take place were actually based on games that happened in real life. For example, the match in which Beth defeats Harry for the Kentucky state title was from a game in Latvia in 1955. One thing Loeb McLean did have problems with, though, was the fact that the speed in which the game is played, with it being much faster than what an actual competition would be like. In real life, the competitors have 2 hours to make 40 moves, while players in the show take mere seconds to make their move, much faster than actual real-life players. That is probably done for the purpose of television, as I don't think people would have time to sit around for 2 hours waiting for players to make their moves.
It's been 5 hours.
Another thing McLean took issue with is the fact that players talk to one another during the match, which is apparently a big no-no in the world of chess, not only being bad sportsmanship, but strictly against the rules. Garry Kasparov had a major influence with his work behind the camera, but he was also offered the chance to play a part in front of it, with the show's creator Scott Frank initially asking him to play the part of Borgov. Kasparov ultimately turned down the role, opting instead to stick with the position behind the scenes. For a show that pays so much attention to detail and to make sure things are as accurate as possible, you might be surprised to learn there is a mathematical mistake in the show. But it doesn't surprise you to learn it was done on purpose. The mistake in question is the teacher's math mistake, 5 times 3 equals 18, which causes the teacher to look for an eraser, which is of course located in the basement where chess is played. One of the constant themes that runs throughout the show is Beth's constant struggles with substance abuse. This stems from her early age at the orphanage, where she is given a diet of different substances to take, one of which is the green drug, Zanzolum, a tranquilizer given to the children in order to make them easier to manage, and consequently breaking a lot of modern-day laws. But if you have never heard of the pill before, there is no reason to be embarrassed, because it actually doesn't exist. While it is based on real-life pills, it only exists in the world of Queen's Gambit. You might be wondering if the story of the Queen's Gambit is based on true events, and to tell you the truth, it is and it isn't. It's because it does make reference to real games and people who actually existed, but the primary source is actually a novel of the same name by Walter Tevis, who wrote The Hustler and The Color of Money. The novel was so popular and such a success that the Netflix series is not the first attempt at bringing this story to the screen. In fact, one of the closest times the novel made it to screen was back in the 2000s, when the late Heath Ledger was attached to make his directorial debut with the adaptation. Ledger was such a big fan of the book that he was apparently very excited, with him feeling related to the character of Beth. The adaptation was so far down the pipeline to become a movie that Inception and Umbrella Academy Ellen Page was signed on to play the role of Beth. Sadly though, Ledger passed away in 2008 and never had the chance to turn his passion project into reality. The novel is so good and such a draw that it was the book alone that convinced Anya Taylor-Joy to sign on to the project. Apparently, the creators approached Taylor-Joy before they had a script and gave her a copy of the novel instead to discuss their plans. Taylor-Joy was so taken by the character and by the story that she immediately agreed before seeing the script and used the book as her main reference. Anya Taylor-Joy may be the biggest name on the call sheet, but like Game of Thrones' Brody Sangster, there are a number of appearances that you might recognize but not know from where. For example, you may recognize the name Marielle Heller, who played Alma Wheatley, and that is because she is the director behind such films as A Beautiful Day in the Neighborhood and Can You Ever Forgive Me? You may also recognize Harry Melling, who plays Harry Metlick, but if you are like me, you may not instantly recognize where from. That's because he has changed somewhat since his Harry Potter days, where he played Harry's thuggish and spoilt cousin Dudley Dursley. Melling has gone through somewhat of a resurgence of late, but will certainly be known for his role as Dudley in Harry Potter, especially to her co-star Taylor-Joy, who is apparently a huge Harry Potter fan, actually learning English through the Harry Potter books as she was raised in Argentina, and apparently Melling graciously sat and listened to Taylor-Joy freaking out about the franchise. Back to the hyper-reality of the show. You were probably wondering about the book Modern Chess Openings that Mr. Scheibel gives Beth, and if it is indeed a real book. Okay, let's face it, you probably weren't wondering that. Sorry again, chess fans. But if you were in the minority who were wondering, it is indeed a real book. Modern Chess Openings, or MCO as it is colloquially known in the chess world, was written by Richard Clewen Griffith and John Herbert White and published in 1911, with 15 editions since published, and is seen as the first scientific... Sorry, I just sent myself to sleep there. I'm going to move on from this before I fall asleep again, because I still have like 6 more entries to go. As we mentioned before, the show makes references to real games, but also references to real people. While Beth Harmon is a fictional character, she is based on a number of real-life chess players. Harry compares Beth to chess champion Paul Morphy, but she actually shares more similarities with another champion, Bobby Fischer. The timeline set in the Queen's Gambit coincides with the peak of Fischer's career, with Beth winning her championship in 1967, while Fischer won his 8th and final championship that very year. Both Beth and Fischer found themselves living alone in their teenage years after their guardians moved out. Both learned Russian as to gain an advantage over their opponents. Both also requested money from the White House to help fund their trip to the USSR, and both of their lavish dress sense caused them to not have enough money to help fund the trip themselves. The one glaring difference is gender. Obviously, Beth is a woman, while Fischer was apparently very dismissive of female players and saw them as inferior. Having the gender flipped in the story could be Tevis's sly dig at Fischer, with Tevis being an amateur player and passionate fan and a supporter of strong female characters. One of Beth's most notable physical traits is her glorious red hair, which makes her look like a member of the Weasley family. Maybe she really is destined for Harry Potter. But you might have guessed that the hair is not actually the actor's own, with the wardrobe department applying a number of wigs to get her into the character. Netflix posted a video of Taylor-Joy's transition into Beth, and it's strangely cathartic. But it's not just the wigs that the wardrobe department get props for. Yeah, now that's a fun. They also get an applause for the use of costume, which if you look closely, has a similar theme throughout. That's because a number of the outfits she wears have lines on them. And you know what also has lines on it? A baseball diamond. And you know what else has lines on it? A football field. And you know what else has lines on it? A chessboard. And I'm gonna assume it's the latter that the wardrobe was paying reference to. But it's not just the wardrobe that has careful detail, but the choice of lipstick that Beth wears. That is because the shade of lipstick Beth wears signifies her age, with the color changing throughout the course of the show. Furthermore, it is a reference to Alma, who serves as Beth's mother figure in the show, with the shade of lipstick being a tribute to her pseudo-mother. That's a strangely touching tribute. I think everyone likes that. And finally, the show may be mostly set in the US as well as ending up in the USSR, now just Russia, but the bulk of filming is actually shot in neither. In fact, the show was actually predominantly filmed in the capital of Germany, Berlin.
Exactly.
What did you make of this video? Are you a fan of the show? Did you catch all of these? Any we missed? Let us know in the comments below and make sure to subscribe to the channel today for all this and more.